Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 12th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item for consideration by the committee is whether to take agenda items 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private this morning. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. The public item on our agenda this morning is consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's work programme, covering the period April 2024 to March 2026. And I'm very pleased this morning to welcome our witnesses, the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Good morning, Stephen. Anthony Clark, who's an Executive Director at Audit Scotland, and Mark McPherson, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland. We've got some comments and questions about your work programme, Auditor General, but before we get to those, could I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm delighted to discuss with the Committee this morning my work programme, which includes my overall priorities and the planned audit work that I'll undertake over the next 2 years. As the Committee knows well, the current operating context for the Scottish Government and public services remains challenging. Rising demands and a constrained financial outlook pose sustainability risks. The Committee has, of course, explored many of these issues in its own current activities. It's never been more important that public money is raised and spent to best effect, and that we get the very best from public assets, such as the people delivering public services, public land and buildings, use of technology, and increasingly, how we use its information and knowledge. This context is what drives my thinking about the future programme of audit work. Through our audits, we want to make sure that public services target resources efficiently, financial management is effective, and public bodies report more transparently. Also, that our audit recommendations have a positive impact. As set out in my work programme, I intend to focus on what public services deliver and how they deliver it. I will consider whether public spending is making a difference. As I have reported, public sector reform has not yet been delivered to the scale required to support future sustainability. That's why I will also be focusing on how public bodies are enabling change individually and also part of a wider system in which they operate. That includes how they are empowering people and communities, spending preventatively, reducing inequalities, and making better use of digital technology to improve their efficiency. Public audit has an important role to play in supporting improvement and sharing good practice to help enable change. Some of the proposed work programme will be familiar to the committee, and I will continue to have an interest in climate change, health and social care, public finances and economic growth activities. The committee will of course also know that I report on the financial audits of Scottish public bodies, highlighting matters in particular of public interest that the committee will again be familiar with through annual Section 22 reports. These naturally vary in number each year depending on the issues identified by appointed auditors. Convener, my work programme of course needs to be flexible, and I plan to continue to use a variety of audit approaches, reporting products, and report on the range of factors impacting on public services. In terms of consultation, lastly, I want to ensure that my work programme considers key areas of interest to the Parliament and focuses on those topics that will add most value in supporting effective parliamentary scrutiny. As ever, I'm grateful for the opportunity to consult with the committee, and I will use the feedback from yourselves and across the Parliament to refine my long-term priorities and work programme. And Mark, Anthony and myself look forward to answering your questions and receiving any comments or feedback that you have this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Auditor General. Can I just start then by looking at some of those contextual factors that you've set out in both your opening statement and the slides that you sent us? I mean, you've identified rising demand for public services at a time of tight finances, deepening inequalities, not least because of the so-called cost of living crisis. You've spoken about the post-pandemic recovery, which is still a live issue for many parts of the public sector. And you've mentioned climate change, but also the need for longer-term reform. So I guess our opening question to you is, how well do you think the government and public bodies are responding and rising to those challenges?
So these are the factors, convener, absolutely, that will inform the choices that public services make in Scotland, both on an individual basis and then that longer-term approach. As I alluded to in my opening remarks, we think there are sustainability issues for the safe and effective delivery of public services in Scotland, and we've stated that in a number of our reports, perhaps most visibly in the overview of the NHS in Scotland, where we've again highlighted that rising demand for services, the impact that it's having on the experience and care that patients are having. But at the same time, the need to think carefully about reform into the future whilst dealing with those here and now challenges. And that's what we want to weave into our work programme with the themes and context that you describe. Perhaps one of the, I'm sure we'll get into some of the specifics of the programme, but maybe one example that somewhat captures those range of factors that's informing the work programme. And we're thinking carefully about where we go next on social security spending in Scotland. So, for example, just and another related output actually that we'll be that we'll prepare towards the end of this year, which firstly will be something of a scene setter about the fiscal position that Scotland is operating in and the choices that it will make. So we will produce that financial report at the end of the year. But as the committee knows, and if I may just make this example, that health spending in Scotland is growing and continues to grow because of the demand, the more complex requirements. But not far behind that, and again informed by the Fiscal Commission's forecasting, will be spending on devolved benefits in Scotland. As these two spending streams continue to grow, it will mean less money for other parts of public service. So we want to look carefully about what benefit and impact they are both having. We'll do that through our continued programme of work on the NHS. But as I referred to in the paper, we plan to do more specific work on the cost and impact of the devolved benefits arrangements in Scotland. We'll continue that through some of our child poverty, which will look at the Scottish child payment over the next couple of years. But next year we'll be reporting, and we'll still to flesh out some of the detail of this convener, on some of the disability benefits, those devolved benefits in Scotland, which will capture some of that rising demand inequalities that exist in Scotland. But stepping back, as we're able to as auditors, what impact and what bearing it's having on the significant sums of public spending that are going into that area.
Okay, I think that's a helpful illustration. We might get into some of the more of the detail of that. Can I just ask you? I was looking back to the session that we held last year on your work programme, and session started off with a discussion about the industrial intervention framework and Ferguson Marine. And I noticed that ferries doesn't appear in your outline work programme. And I think we produced a report around this time last year where we made some recommendations about the need to have a review at the completion of the contract at what went wrong, what happened, where the lessons can be learned, and so on. And I think at that point you were expecting to carry that work out. But it's not mentioned in the work programme. I just wonder whether you could update us on that.
Yeah, for absolute clarity, convener, the correspondence that I've exchanged with the committee reflects the position of myself and Audit Scotland. I will be carrying out audit work on Ferguson Marine, reflecting on the project to deliver Glen Sannox and Glen Rosa. And the reason it's not reflected specifically is because of the uncertainty about the timing of that. But that is not in any doubt we will be carrying out a performance audit at the conclusion of the launch of the two vessels.
Okay, it was just that the work programme that we're considering this morning is from April, well, it goes up until March 2026, doesn't it? So I suppose our expectation is that by March 2026, those two vessels will be serving the island communities of Scotland. You don't need to answer that question. Can I just... Yes, Graham, yes, of course.
Sorry, just a point of clarity. on that question. So you say, Auditor General, you'll start that work when the vessels are launched. Do you mean when the vessels are in service?
So Mr. Simpson, we haven't specified a precise date for which we will commence the audit that reflects on the project to to deliver the two vessels. I think that's something that we'll need to take a bit of time as we await the completion of the vessels. For reassurance for the committee, we remain actively involved and are tracking the progress of the two vessels, both through our wider performance programme, but also through the annual audit of Fergus Marine Port Glasgow. And I think that will inform when is the right time. But there is no doubt, and hopefully my reassurance is sufficient for the committee this morning, that we will be carrying out that work as we've stated in our correspondence.
I think that's helpful, the record. Can I move us along to another area of work in the pipeline, and that is the work that you're expecting to do on care experience, children and young people. Could you give us a bit more detail about that work and why you see that as a priority for you, Auditor General?
Yeah, very much so, Convener. I'll bring Mark in a second, who will be leading some of that work. But both the Accounts Commission and myself, and I should say that much of my programme of work we will deliver jointly with the Accounts Commission. And I think that reflects really, I suppose, again, what I referred to in my opening remarks, is that the system-wide nature of public service delivery doesn't respect some of the organisational boundaries. And that's very much the case for the programme of work to support the experiences that children and young people from a care experience background get, their success of domestic life, educational attainment, and then prospects once they leave the care system. The committee will know that this is a high-profile commitment that the government has made through the establishment of the Promise that brings in the work of many organisations across Scotland to support better outcomes towards the end of this decade. So we'll be looking at that. We'll be looking at the organisation, the Promise itself, the accountability arrangements, and then the contribution that many public bodies are making, Convener. But Mark can say more about where we'll be going with that.
Yeah, I don't have a huge amount to add to that, other than to say that obviously there have been, you know, fairly public discussions about the pace of progress around the implementation of the Promise. Given the high-profile nature of that commitment, it's important, I think, that Audit does take a look at the arrangements and see what progress has been made. The question is just exactly when we would want to do that. We've suggested mid-2025. That's based on what we think will be available at the appropriate points to allow us to conduct a detailed and robust piece of audit work.
Anthony.
I thought it might be worth mentioning the fact that this is probably quite an interesting test case for us of how well public service reform is being delivered. Because as the Auditor General and Mark have said, this isn't just a matter for the Scottish Government or the Promise Board or the Promise itself. It involves councils, communities and the third sector as well. We know from quite a few pieces of previous audit work that there are real challenges in getting change to happen when you have to work in partnership with others. So we think this would be a good opportunity to really test how well that leadership at national and local level is delivering. It also touches on a number of priority areas for the Auditor General and the committee, inequalities and improving outcomes. And given the, I think, well-accepted critique that we haven't yet delivered on Christie, this will be a good test of, are we making more progress with Christie now than we had over recent years as well?
Yeah. Can I raise a related issue, which is you've also identified children and young people with additional support needs as an area that you want to focus in on. Again, could you give us a bit more detail about why you treat that as a priority area of work for Audit Scotland?
Yeah, very much so, Convener. Again, Mark and Anthony, we want to develop my opening remarks on this. I guess a range of factors, both in referencing the Morgan Review, but also the ongoing interest of the Education, Children and Young People's Committee in the Parliament, about how well primarily Scotland's councils are meeting their obligations to deliver services for children and young people with additional support needs. We know that demand for services for children and young people with additional support needs is growing. So we want to look at the totality of the arrangements, again, building on Anthony's comment about how the system is operating to best support those services. You'll see in the narrative accompanying our intentions, convener, that we make reference to the quality of information and data that is in place to support that delivery. Again, a recurring theme of interest, I know, for the committee, that the provision of education service in this area, the ability of providers to make informed decisions, is so reliant upon having high quality data. And then it tracing back to the investment that public services are making in this area. Is it meeting the needs of learners? Is it delivering the impact and difference that's expected of it? So that's our intention. Again, Mark can say more as he wishes.
I think just to add to the point about the increase in demand, there's also variation in demand, which may or may not be easily explained. We obviously recognise there's also a real spectrum of the needs that are likely to be in amongst the system, and obviously that leads to a question about the variation in provision. So it lends itself well to what I would call a classic performance audit piece of work. That complex spectrum of needs will obviously require us to get our heads around what that involves and how individual councils are responding to those across the country.
Yeah, and then Karen, that work out, you will be, I presume, working with the Parliament's Education, Children and Young People's Committee.
Yeah, indeed, and Anthony will develop this, but we're looking carefully at the timing of it. Actually, I think we're given the fact that the review is being undertaken by the committee, and that its scope is significant and potentially overlapping with where we might have started. I think we want to really see the results of that review, first of all, before settling on our scope. We don't think it is one for us to step back from, convener, in light of that review, because I think it's important that there's an audit angle brought to this that the committee may or may not be able to provide. So, yes, we're very mindful of that work, but we're just going to wait to see what they conclude before settling on our final scope.
Yeah, we've already given evidence to the committee on this topic as part of their inquiry, and it's pretty clear that the committee has an interest in the overall level of funding, whether it's being allocated appropriately. And there's a big question mark about the balance of funding between specific funding streams that are dedicated to specialist services as opposed to mainstream services that are provided by local authorities. The committee was quite keen that Audit Scotland explores that as part of any work we might do.
OK, that's very helpful. I'm going to move things along and invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, I've got three broad areas that I want to touch on. The first one is, you know, over the years, this committee has generally received Section 22 and Section 23 reports from you, which we are obviously in-depth audits, and we've based our scrutiny on these. Over the last, I suppose, couple of years, we've increasingly getting briefings and blogs from yourself. So there's a couple of questions around that. One is, what kind of balance do you anticipate in the future between your in-depth audits and the briefings and blogs? And given that this committee has performed scrutiny against those briefings and blogs, to what extent can we rely on the rigour of the audit principles behind it when we're taking this forward?
It's a really important question. I'm glad you've raised it, Mr. Beattie. Actually, I'm sure Anthony and indeed Mark might want to set out really the structures and processes we have in place, firstly, behind the scenes that satisfy the quality standards and can assure the committee about the basis on which not just yourselves who will take scrutiny as a key role that is, but really anybody using the report, the public can rely upon the judgments that are included. And those standards apply whether it's a Section 22 report, Section 23, or indeed some of the more recent products that we have used, blogs, online publications, and briefings. I mean, I'll pass to Anthony in a second, but I think the reason that we want to have a wider suite of outputs is that it gives us flexibility. Typically in a blog or an online publication or a briefing, to raise a matter of audit interest and hopefully public interest, probably a bit more nimbly than we would be able to were it a full-scale Section 22 or 23. There is often an intention, Mr. Beattie, on the back of a briefing paper or a blog to signal that this is our intent to undertake more in-depth audit work. in a relatively short space of time thereafter. And it's that kind of flow through that I think gives us the opportunity to continue that the audit work and the audit interest. But none of that should detract from all of our work has to be safe, reliable and to the same quality standards. And I may pass it to Anthony as the executive director of, who leads this work, just to kind of set out how we go about that.
Thanks. It's a very good question, Mr. Beattie. As the Auditor General's said, when we're conducting our briefings, they do have to comply with auditing standards, the InterSci standards that apply to all of our performance audit work. It means that we need to satisfy ourselves that we've got a clear scope for the work, we've gathered sufficient, reliable audit evidence, we have a log of all the key judgments that we've made, and the briefings, as are our performance audits, are subject to independent review as well, to satisfy the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission that the work is being done to an appropriate standard. So we're pretty satisfied, I think, that when we do the briefings, we can stand behind them. To be honest, we wouldn't put anything out in the public domain that wasn't of the highest possible standard. I wouldn't be able to sleep at night, nor would Stephen, if that wasn't the case. I think it's not surprising that the committee takes an interest in the briefings, because we only do a briefing because there's a topic of audit interest there. There's an audit issue that we need to get our heads around and feel the need to report publicly on. So therefore, it seems not surprising to me that the committee then wants to, on occasion, to take evidence and gather further evidence on those matters.
I guess the issue from the committee's point of view is, as the Auditor General said, often if a briefing comes out, it's signalling there's probably a more detailed Section 22 report coming behind that. And it's then an issue for the committee as to whether to take action and allocate time for a scrutiny based on the briefing or wait for the full Section 22 coming forward later on. I realise that's a judgment for the committee at the time, but it does sort of create that uncertainty.
I recognise the dilemma, Mr. Beattie. I think what we try to do is hopefully allow for a sufficient gap that it doesn't feel like there's a too condensed an issue all at the one time. There's a live example that maybe kind of helps illustrate some of our thinking around Scotland's justice system. And mindful, of course, that the committee is, you know, still in the throes of taking evidence on the Section 22 on the Scottish Prison Service and your own interest in that. But you recall that in 2021, there was a briefing paper that I produced on the criminal justice system in Scotland. And at that point, you know, we drew attention to the fact that the system hadn't progressed at the pace that was intended of the creation of the new bodies and the wider legislation. In today's paper of our programme of work, we set out that we want to do more work in the criminal justice and community justice arrangements, but thinking, what's the best way to frame that? Is it progressing as planned? So there are choices, and I think it's really that option of choices that I want to have to how best to deliver products. But I am mindful of not to condense a topic too closely together so that it cannibalises or overlaps to the extent that it reduces the quality of scrutiny that the committee can provide.
Have you had an instance yet where you've put out in all good faith a briefing and then when the full scrutiny takes place that the content of that briefing is modified?
In terms of
the severity of the impact it would appear to have?
I can think of an example whereby, unless I bring colleagues in to support that whereby we've reflected and said that we would have been better placed to have produced a full-scale performance audit on that topic. I think probably brings me back to think that we have options. We have options either through undertaking a Section 23 report or doing an impact style analysis of the work or taking it through the annual audit process. As you'll know, audit work never really stops on a particular topic. You know, there's always scrutiny, there's always an ongoing assessment. I think the arrangements that we have give us the right degree of flexibility. And as Anthony mentioned, we've not had a concern about the quality of a briefing or an online publication to the extent that we've had to step back or modify at the moment. But again, I'll bring Anthony and Mark to develop.
If the question is basically, have we done a briefing and realised that the issue wasn't really an issue? That's never been the case. There's always been something worthwhile to see and find when we've done our briefing work. Having said that, when you're doing a piece of audit work, there's always a question in your mind about how big, how significant are the nature of the issues that you're investigating. And I think it's probably fair for us to reflect that when we're doing our work, we also look for the good as well as the bad. So inevitably, there's a balance to be struck in terms of making sure that when we're doing our work, we're looking for things that are going well and areas we can support improvement. But I don't think we've ever found ourselves in positions to be to where we've conducted a piece of work and we thought, forgive me if I'm being colloquial here, why did we bother? That's not been the case.
Just add, it's important to note, I think, that not all briefings will necessarily progress to a full performance audit, a full Section 23 report. And I think that's something that's worth us reflecting on in terms of how we're presenting information and reports to the committee. Is this something where you will produce something later and then there's an opportunity to discuss when the right time is for the committee to commence more detailed scrutiny? On other occasions, the briefing may be sufficient and may be enough to really go into the topic for the committee. And I think that's something we can liaison as we progress.
Just coming back to the original question, what sort of balance do you see in that in the future between the more formal Section 22s and 23s and these less formal briefings and blogs?
So Section 22s, as I mentioned, to an extent, they take care of themselves. So that if the appointed auditor raises a matter through their annual audit and brings that to my attention through well-established processes that we have in Audit Scotland, I'll make a decision whether to produce a report on the annual audit. In terms of Section 23 and the balance with briefing papers, I don't like, as you'll no doubt expect, Mr. Beattie, there's no formula that says that this is a percentage of one or the other. I think what we want to do is to ensure that we've got the right depth for the right issues, so that for some products, just will lend themselves to a full-scale audit. Mark's mentioned some already. I think, as I mentioned, first response to the convener, Social Security feels like a good example. So the committee will recall that from really the tracing back to the Scotland Act of 2016 and the plan to devolve more benefits to Scotland, there was a programme of reporting that Audit Scotland then embarked upon of work through the annual audit, and then reporting on how well the arrangements were developing. And as I mentioned, it's our intention to carry out further reporting. I think a Section 23 is the right product for that style of work, given the scale of public spending that exists, that it's a programme that's had a number of years under its belt. But for other topics, a briefing will also be as appropriate. We've mentioned about the promise, for example, already. So we're just thinking carefully about how we shape that. And we'll always do that really on the scale of the issue, the amount of public spending, and what additional benefit one product or another will bring.
Thank you. Just to move on to another issue, which is around Scotland's colleges and the approach on that. Obviously, over a large number of years now, Scotland's colleges have continually been coming forward as an issue. But the issue behind them has sort of changed over the years. The emphasis has changed over the years. Now, always there's finances behind it, and at the moment you're obviously expressing concerns about the financial sustainability of the sector. The new funding model from the SFC and the ability to the colleges continue to offer the courses that they need to offer. Their financial situation is obviously driven at the moment, as it wasn't so much in the past, by staffing costs. We hear, we've seen some fairly dramatic statements from colleges as to the percentages of the resources that are being eaten up by that, or will be eaten up by that in the future. Now, all of this is a very changing environment. It's kind of fast paced. It's things that are have developed over. Developed over the years, and it's fast-paced, but you get where I'm coming from. How are you going to change the type of output that you're going to publish for this? Because obviously we're looking at entirely different things now, and the old types of report that you produced on this were appropriate at the time to the issues at the time, but we're in a new world now, so to speak. How are you going to approach that?
Yes, again, I'm glad you raised it. Again, Mark and Anthony may wish to comment on this point as well. Mark, particularly, who's leading our work on Scotland's colleges. Your characterisation of the environment is one I would recognise, Mr. Beattie, that this is a very challenging, dynamic context that Scotland's colleges are currently operating in. And I value the committee's interest in this, your ongoing scrutiny of the challenges that Scotland's colleges are facing. It's not a system or a sector that operates in isolation, of course, and that there are currently plans for reform more generally of Scotland's post-school system is relevant to shape where we'll take our work. To some extent, and Mark can say more, I was going to say a placeholder, but I think that perhaps downplays the significance with which we attach to Scotland's colleges through our audit work. I think you've alluded to an evolution of our reporting on Scotland's colleges. For a number of years, we produced an annual overview of the college sector in Scotland. More recently, we've continued to report, but perhaps in a more accessible format that reflects, I would say, a growing desire of the Scottish Funding Council to discharge more of its responsibilities in terms of annual reporting in the sector. So we've reflected that through our own work, but we're not tied to a particular style of reporting on the sector. I think all I would maybe just, without committing ourselves this morning, if that's possible, to one style of output over another, is that our interest in the sector is undiminished, given the important role that it plays in terms of social mobility, tackling inequalities, and the life chances that the sector provides across multiple communities throughout Scotland, Mr. Beattie. So we'll just take a bit of time to get this right. Any feedback from the committee and elsewhere will help shape that. But Mark can say more again about where that might take us.
Yeah, I think importantly, I would emphasise the fact that, as the Auditor General has said, we're not tied to a particular type of output or particular scope, and we are giving thought to that. In the past, when previous versions of the report, if you like, the annual report, we have touched into things like performance, curriculum, staffing in a bit more detail, as well as regionalisation arrangements when they came in and mergers. So there is capacity and flexibility for us to do something around that. I think we know that for the past few years, the primary driver in the sector, or the primary challenge in the sector, has been financial sustainability. Some of that is now coming to, I don't want to say fruition, but you've seen through some of the comments that the colleges have made and those useful evidence sessions, I think, that the committee had with both the SFC and the Director General of the Scottish Government, as well as the colleges themselves, really brought to light some of the real issues that colleges are facing. So we will be reflecting on what is the appropriate scope of any output that we do in future on colleges.
Okay, thank you. Let me just turn to the last question I was going to ask you, which is about the police and fire and rescue. Your best value reports, actually, I think, are quite good. I'm Scottish, that's my... anyway, they are. And I know you're doing research and development work on policing, and you're doing a best value audit on this. Can you give me a bit more information about what research and development work is being done and the timescales you're working to in relation to the fire and rescue services? Because obviously both these emergency services are really vital for the country and the committee has a huge interest in them.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Beattie. A wee bit of background first, and then Anthony and Mark can say more as they wish, is that uniquely on the Scottish Police Authority and Scottish Fire and Rescue under the Police and Fire Reform 2012 Act, this gave the Auditor General powers of best value on what are now central government organisations of police and fire in Scotland following that significant element of public sector reform. Neither myself nor my predecessor have discharged those best value powers yet, and I think This has been a placeholder in the Forward Work programme now for a few years. And as I set out in the paper this morning, it's my intention to carry out best value reporting on both police and fire over the current audit appointment term. That's not my appointment, but it's the current five-year cycle of external audit appointments, which takes us up to 2027, I should say. Your predecessor committee, of which you sat, of course, Mr. Beattie, took much evidence on the progress that particularly the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland was making as in terms of the quality of its service post-reform. I wanted to take a bit of time to allow that stabilisation to happen before going in to make a wider assessment of how Police Scotland, the Police Authority, and then the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, which has had a lower profile, but you know still provides a vital public service. So that's my intention. You'll see from the paper we are signposting that we'll produce the first set of reports towards the end of next year. And we're working closely with the appointed auditors of both organisations, together with Anthony and Mark's team. Anthony can maybe kick off, actually, but in terms of the specifics of the work that we're taking to ready ourselves for that.
Yeah, we're in very active discussions with both of the inspectorates around this work because they have a clear interest. And I think it's probably worth recognising there was a piece of work that was done by Stephen's predecessor, Caroline Gardner, which was commenting on the preparation and planning for police and fire reform. So at that point, we took a view that there had been good progress made in terms of planning for implementation. But the question then was, well, has it actually made a difference? You know, has the intention of creating a single police service and a single fire and rescue service led to better quality, better performance and better use of public resources? Now feels like the right time to step back and start trying to form a view on that broader kind of performance and outcome question. And that's the conversation that we're having with HMI, CS and HMFSI at the moment. As Stephen said, plan would be to get that work kicked off. Well, sooner rather than later, because it will take a bit of time and it's not straightforward work. And we've also got the reference points of the work that was done by the Accounts Commission around the previous police and fire services in Scotland as well, to give us a bit of a reference of how was it then, how is it now, what difference has happened.
Before passing to Mark, the thing I would add, Mr. Beattie, and you're familiar with this, is that all accountable officers of central government bodies, of which is the accountable officer for the police is the chief executive of the Scottish Police Authority, inherent to their role is a responsibility to achieve best value arrangements. It doesn't accompany that in central government in the way that it does in local authorities is a statutory element to that alongside audit reporting. So there's work to do here for us, and we think the timing is beginning to feel pretty fertile to do some public reporting. Is that fair, Mark?
Really just a very practical point that in terms of engagement, we're very closely engaged with HMICS at the moment because of the breadth of the work that they're doing and have done in the police over the last year or two, and we want to work closely with them on shaping what the work might look like. We're less advanced in the discussions with HMFSI, but we are engaged with them too, and we'll be upping that engagement over the coming months.
I think I would just highlight the high level of public interest in both these areas and indeed the interest of this committee in them. And I think I'd be hoping for something as soon as it's feasible to come out with this.
Yes, absolutely. So we will be reporting as at the time scale, we signal 2025, probably for the first of these reports, and then likely into the following year for the other. If I may just reference back to your earlier question, this will be... These won't be briefing papers. These will be full-scale best value audit and assessments, to given the significance of public spending and how material these public services are.
Yeah, I'm seeing lots of nods around the table for that. I think the strong view of this committee is that they should be a priority for the work that you're doing. It is a matter of considerable public interest. I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson to put some questions to you. Graham.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Convener. I just want to follow up on a couple of the areas that Colin Beattie touched on. So he ended on police and the Fire and Rescue Service. And I just wonder about the the sort of level of detail of work that you're planning there. I mean, you're going to be... So if we take the Fire and Rescue Service, for example, will you be looking at whether cuts in the number of assets that the Fire and Rescue Service has had affects its ability to fight fires, particularly major fires, in certain places? Are you going into that sort of level of detail? You could do the same work for police as well.
So I think that Anthony can say more about our methodology, Mr. Simpson, but you know, I think the real benefit that we'll get from this audit is that we will work with subject experts, both in terms of both inspectorates. The audit angle will always be rooted in what public money did the organisation get? Does it get? What are its plans? Did it deliver as intended against those plans? Does it have the right infrastructure in terms of effective decision-making, culture, governance, and so forth? These are the hallmarks of which auditors use to arrive at a best value judgment. But I think Anthony can say more about it, but the performance is vital to that, you know, in terms of the use of resources, which is another key aspect that captures best value.
Just to echo what the Auditor General said, Mr. Simpson, I mean, the Fire and Rescue Inspectorate already publishes inspection reports on fire and rescue. And one of the areas of interest that the Chief Inspector has been focusing on recently has been capacity and deployment and the risks around the level of resources that are available and some of the difficult choices that need to be made. So I think it's quite likely that would feature as part of our discussions with the Fire Inspectorate and possibly the reporting that we'll do in this area. When we did the BV work on police and fire in the past, slightly different models for police and fire. The BV reports were joint reports with the Police Inspectorate, but the Fire and Rescue reports were just reports published by Audit Scotland. I suspect on this occasion these will be joint reports perhaps with those bodies, but that's another matter of detail we need to work through. It creates complications in terms of governance and sign-off and all those kind of things, but you know, we need to do what's right, and that's not stuff that would get us in the way of doing joint reporting if we think that's the right model.
Okay, that's useful. If we could just go back to colleges, I think we're expecting to see a number of Section 22 reports from you. I wonder if you can give us an update on where you are with those.
Happy to. I haven't settled on Section 22 reporting on Scotland's colleges for their financial year 22-23 yet. I'm in active consideration as I await the finalisation of those annual audits. Some of those are taking longer than expected. There are complex judgments that are being made by auditors. But as really referencing again, I think the evidence that the committee took from the college sector, particularly the Scottish Funding Council, about the scale of challenges that are live, we are seeing that being reported by the annual auditors in their annual audit reports. And that's informing my thinking, but I haven't settled on specific colleges or numbers yet, Mr. Simpson.
Why are the audits taking longer than expected?
a number of reasons. Timescale, some started later than allowing for the completion of the previous year's audits. And there are some challenging issues, both in terms of the capacity of some finance teams to support the delivery of an effective audit. And there are some live technical issues too, particularly around pension accounting. Many of Scotland's colleges are members, admitted bodies of the local government pension scheme. Mm-hmm. And that's going through its tri-annual valuation arrangements that have been received during the midst of the audit. Many auditors view that's a material change, that they require updated information that requires to be validated before they are prepared to sign off the auditor's certificate. So that's been a number of the factors behind the delay. And then there are some local complexities that are allowing that we want to take account of properly. I've said this many times to the committee, but audit quality matters more than the delivery of deadlines. And auditors won't compromise on the quality of the judgments that they need to make with the right evidence. So these are the factors that are live just now, Mr. Simpson.
Okay, so I mean, can we expect to see some progress before the summer?
Yeah, very much hope so. I think that the outstanding audits, and Mark can have some of the detail on this if it's helpful, we expect will be completed before summer recess, and that any resultant Section 22s will be reported publicly by that date. As I do, I will be writing to the committee with regular updates on progress and my intentions. Anything to add, Mark?
No, nothing to add. Thanks.
OK, fine. Can I ask you, you say you're going to do some work on looking at primary care, the care provided by GPs. Mm. What kind of things will you be looking at there?
Anthony, if you want to say more about that in a second. I guess the sentence that I would highlight to the committee in shaping our thinking is really, you know, where health services take place in Scotland. So over 90% of health interactions take place in primary care.
Yeah.
And that also is informed by our regular reporting on the NHS about the need to move to a preventative model that's less focused, less reliant upon large hospitals in an acute setting. The new general practitioner contract, the GMS contract, is now in place since 2018. We want to see how effectively that's working, Mr. Simpson. So that will be at the heart of our audit intentions there. Where we go next with the scope and methodology, Anthony can say as much as we're able to at this stage.
We're still at the scoping discussions with our stakeholder group around this piece of work, Mr. Simpson, but as your General said, the focus primarily is on whether or not the 2018 GMS contract is delivering what it was intended to deliver. It was a fundamental shift to try and shift resources into primary care, yeah, and deliver services differently to help support the prevention agenda and improve health outcomes. We know there have been some real issues, and there still are some big issues around capacity in primary care. There appears to be evidence of challenges in recruiting some of the multidisciplinary teams that are at the cornerstone of delivering those different services. So we want to explore how well that programme of change is being implemented and what the barriers might be and what might need to be done differently in the future. But we still haven't finalised the scope, but that's a general thrust of what we're looking at the moment.
Well, I think you're right to look at capacity, but could I also urge you, as part of that work, to look at, and we've raised this before in committee, how easy or difficult it is for patients to actually see a GP, because I think there's a bit of a mixed picture, and different practices will have different policies on actually booking appointments. It comes down to something as basic as that.
We're certainly quite keen, I think, to explore whether or not we can get good evidence on access and availability of primary care services. I think it's quite likely that will feature as part of our audit interest in this piece of work, but I certainly hear what you're saying loud and clear, Mr. Simpson, and made a note of that.
I would add, as Anthony says, we're just in the scoping of this audit, but as the committee saw in our adult mental health services report, we were very deliberate in our intention to bring in the experiences that people have of public services, both from, you know, the specifics of it, lived experience, and also where appropriate, a human rights-based approach to auditing as well, Mr. Simpson. So we've not settled on it yet, but that feels like a very important component of our thinking as we do so for this audit.
Okay, that's useful. I'm going to ask you now about your work on sustainable transport and climate change. So if we could start on climate change, we're meant to be getting a statement today on climate change, but it was leaked, so we know what's coming. We know that the government is going to say that they're going to ditch the targets which are set down in law. Does that help or hinder you in your audit work?
I'll maybe firstly resist commenting on a potential leak, and I understand there'll be a ministerial statement to the Chamber today that will set out the government's intentions around its climate change, the statutory targets and the annual plan. You'll recall, Mr. Simpson, we've recently produced two climate change related audits, firstly on the government's overall arrangements to support its climate change ambitions, which made reference, of course, to the annual climate change plan, and then also more recently on heat in homes and how that work is progressing. Whatever change the government makes, I'm not sure in terms of both its ambitions for the interim targets in 2030 or indeed the annual reporting, I'm not sure it really derails the wider ambition to into the 2040s, that there's a clear plan of intention of how it will deliver its carbon reduction ambitions, and then which is relevant for our work on the use of cars and reducing car mileage journeys. So that was one of the first aspects we were looking at.
Yeah.
But then the second one is really that assumption that climate change is here to stay, and the extent to which public bodies and public services are adapting appropriately. And a specific of that is our intention, given the climate in Scotland, is to look at how well are flood protection arrangements being deployed in Scotland. So it's those two aspects that we intend to look at. And of course, we'll look with interest about the government's decisions around its targets and use that to inform our future work here.
Okay. With regard to sustainable transport then, what are you going to be looking at there? Are you going to be looking at all kinds of transport? Cars, trains, planes, ferries?
Anthony can say more.
The primary focus will be on reducing car travel. That's a primary focus for the audit, but we will be looking at the extent to which planning is taking place at local level and regional level to try and get integrated transport systems, because that's an important part of the mix, really. But the primary focus is on the target to reduce levels of car use.
Why are you not looking at all other forms of transport?
Well, we'll look at the connection between local planning to reduce car use and how it's linked with other investments or other modalities of transport. But the reason we're focusing primarily on cars is because that is the biggest area of carbon emissions, and that's where there's likely to be the greatest gain in terms of supporting Scotland's drive to meeting net zero.
Okay. And I suppose the government does have a target. Well, it hasn't ditched that one yet, but maybe they'll get around to that. Are you going to be looking at the use of electric vehicles and the rollout of EV chargers or lack of?
I'm very glad you asked that question, Mr. Simpson, because we've had quite a lot of discussions internally about the scope of this audit. And we will obviously be thinking about the role that electric vehicles can play in supporting the shift and the reduction in car use. But the evidence suggests that shouldn't be the primary focus of this piece of work. So we are planning to do specific work on electric vehicles in the future. It will feature as part of the context for this piece of work, but it's not the primary focus of it.
So the focus of your work is simply, are people using cars less?
Yes. Are people adopting more active forms of transport? Are they using more public transport? What progress are people making at local, regional and national level to deliver that shift in behaviour and activity?
Okay. Well, I can probably tell the answer to that. The answer is no at the moment. There is no plan.
I think we want to see, to be perfectly honest, Mr. Right. Simpson, and certainly the scoping work, it gives us some useful hooks to explore the extent to which there is good activity at local level to make those shifts happen. And if it isn't happening, well, clearly we need to shout it out and identify what needs to be done better in the future.
OK, I'll look forward to seeing that. My final question is, we've spoken to you previously about how you track your recommendations in terms of, how government responds to them and what action is taken as a result of the many recommendations. And I should say, unlike Mr. Beattie, I think your reports are excellent. Not just quite good, excellent. So as a result of your excellent recommendations, how are you actually tracking the progress of that?
Anthony, you can come in a second. Well, firstly, thank you for the feedback. We've thought carefully about this, and you're right, we've had very helpful discussions with the committee, building on the work of the predecessor committee, that audit work has an impact. And I think I referenced this a couple of times in my opening remarks, Mr. Simpson. And that's central to our strategy that was produced. That reasserted that last year between myself, the Accounts Commission, and supported by Audit Scotland, the Public Audit in Scotland. The audit work with clear audit recommendations is producing an impact ultimately through to better public services. So we're very focused and committed on that. At one end of the spectrum, it is for public bodies to either accept or reject an audit recommendation, and that's very obviously a feature of questioning that the convener asks of witnesses before you. On the expectation that we go through the regular clearance process, that they are clear, understood and hopefully accepted, for public bodies to implement them, and then for us to track and report on how well that is happening. So we currently have a project, our impact and insights, that we are reporting and committed to report publicly at least twice over the five-year duration of our strategy. And we'll be giving regular updates to the committee and to our own annual reporting about the progress that's been made. Alongside that, I think it's been a helpful development, particularly from the Scottish Government's perspective, that its own audit and assurance committee has a much clearer and stronger arrangements for which it is tracking its progress against audit recommendations. And we'll be reporting further on that through the audit of the Scottish Government later this year. So I feel that there is more happening, there is clearer progress that is being made. And again, if I may, before passing to Anthony, I can say a bit more about this, is that audit, yes, it's a retrospective function, and some of our work here is moving towards a bit more real-time auditing. But on the point about have recommendations been implemented, that is a retrospective analysis. So we will go back sometimes 2-3 years to see what happened to that recommendation, and we'll continue to engage and report publicly as appropriate on that. Anthony?
As the Auditor General said, we've introduced a much more systematic approach in Audit Scotland over recent times to follow up on the progress that's being made against recommendations. Obviously, it's really important that the recommendations are accepted, and that's, as the Auditor General said, picked up as part of the clearance process. But accepting a recommendation and acting on it are two different things.
Yes.
So we're probably more interested in many ways on what actual action is being taken. Colleagues have been doing work with audit teams to gather evidence on tranches of audits. So we do a cycle. We allow an appropriate period of time to have elapsed before we start to check whether or not progress has been made. You need to give people time to, gather their resources, act on things. And the evidence is pretty positive for us in terms of the action that's being taken. We're seeing, I think, real progress in audited bodies based on the reports we've looked at recently, getting better at being clear on what it is they're trying to achieve. Also, we're seeing evidence of public bodies getting better at putting systems in place to gather evidence on improvements that we're asking them to make. And the other bit of this that's quite important for us is, obviously we're precluded from passing comment on matters of public policy, but inevitably the points we make, the issues we identify, can be useful in terms of informing policy thinking and service development across the public sector as well. And I think we're seeing good evidence of the briefing on drug and alcohol, for example, informing the work of the task group. And I think we've seen good evidence of the social care briefing, helping to inform some of the thinking around the National Care Service as well. So we feel we're making good progress. There's been a technical change we've introduced as well, which is as part of our audit processes, we now require audit teams, sorry, this sounds a bit dull, to fill in a template, a recommendation template, but it requires the teams to be absolutely clear, who are you directing this recommendation at? What do you want them to do about it? How will you know when they've done it? And how are you going to check whether or not that's actually happened? And we have conversations with the audited bodies around that template as well, which again gives us more confidence that people are buying into the recommendations we're making in the report. Not at all complacent on this. There's obviously more to do, but I think we've made some good progress in terms of putting in place really robust processes around recommendations.
Okay. That's really good, Mr. Clark. It wasn't that dull. Don't worry.
Okay. Thank you very much. I have to comment that it's not uncommon for accountable officers from public bodies to tell the committee at 9:05 in the morning that they accept all of their findings and recommendations, and by about 9:20 they are denouncing or renouncing some of them. But anyway, Willie Coffey's got some questions to put to you.
Thanks very much, convener. Just briefly on that point there, Stephen, if I may, how does the public see the fruits of that particular follow-up work and recommendations? For example, say the public went on to Audit Scotland's website and picked any report, and then, per se, it was a couple of years ago, for example, how do they quickly and easily see the follow-up and the work that was done as part of the recommendations to get a sense of whether the recommendations were carried through?
Yeah. Anthony can probably best place to comment on this, Mr. Coffey, right. But it's so important because really, you know, it's all well and good us making a recommendation, or indeed, as the convener suggests, you know, stating publicly, as Anthony mentions, what happens next is much more important. And so, Anthony, over to you.
Yeah, we're not at the point at the moment, Mr. Coffey, of putting that stuff in the public domain, but that is our ambition to do very, very quickly, because we're now more confident that we've got the processes in place that allow us to have confidence in the evidence that we've got in terms of the progress that's being made or not being made around the recommendations. So that's something we're planning to do really quite soon. I wouldn't want to put a timescale on it, but it's certainly something we want to do. And you know that we're very keen to share this stuff with the committee. Again, I think we've had private discussions around this stuff. We'd be very comfortable, I think, moving into a public discussion space around this work with the committee, if that's where you were minded to go.
I would add, Mr. Coffey, that, you know, as well as the development of the arrangements that Anthony sets out, there's a couple of other specifics that can give that public reporting and maybe confidence to the committee. So Section 22 reports, for example, will regularly say, here is an issue, the recommendations that the auditor has made, almost always results in a follow-up report from me publicly to the committee and says, and here's what happened next over the course of the following year. And then the other product that Audit Scotland has used many times is an impact report. So a specific piece of work, typically on the back of a larger scale Section 22 report, say, well, what happened a number of years later? I think what we're looking to do through this project is to evolve that into a more regular, systematic style of public reporting.
Mm-hmm. And it's connecting it, isn't it, so that someone, say, from the public can visually see, there's a report that was done 2 years ago, there's the actions, recommendations, and the impact of that. They must be able to actually connect the two up and see pretty readily that the work has been done and it's been effective.
Agreed.
Almost like an epilogue to your excellent reports, perhaps.
And there's a really important point around that. I think, you know, we talk about relevance and impact. We want our reports to have a life beyond publication date, you know, that it sees an impact on the delivery of high quality public services to people who are using them, and public money is well spent. So this is how we think we can best bookend that.
Okay, thank you.
I should say, for us, there's an important learning point as well. I mean, I think we need to accept that sometimes recommendations won't be accepted, and sometimes progress against them may be slower than we would like. If that is the case, we need to understand what's happening there, and we need to find better ways of influencing and shaping change across public services. And if the problem lies with us, in terms of how we framed a recommendation, we need to be able to accept that and learn from it as well.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. Can I turn to the work that you're doing on digital exclusion? We know your report's coming, so I don't know how much of a game you want to give away, but could you just give us a little flavour of the issues and themes that you're covering in this, Stephen? And I might follow up with some questions, depending on what you say.
Of course. Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Yeah, this is a live audit that we have, a joint piece of work on behalf of myself and the Accounts Commission. And the roots of it are, I think, as we've all seen and are witnessing, the pace of change and both the delivery of public service and how they are using technology. That pace will be right for some people, but not for others, Mr. Coffey. And it's importantly considering the extent to which people can continue to access public services that are using digital technology more than they had been. So we're in the final throes of that audit at the moment, and we'll be publishing over the next few months to set out, you know, the extent to which public services are delivering all that is required of them in in an environment that has to change at the same time. So, you know, it's quite clear, and indeed the government has set out its ambitions in terms of the pillars of public sector reform, that adoption of digital and digital technologies will very clearly be a part of that. But public services, of course, provide a safety net to members of the public, that they have to still be able to access them in an appropriate way. Maybe not a fair comparator, Mr. Coffey, but public services aren't banks. You know, so you know, if banks are changing their model of service delivery as commercial entities, that's not necessarily the model that public services can mirror. So we're looking at all of that. And also, as we touched on once or twice already this morning, looking to reflect people's lived experiences of digital access, digital exclusion in their lives too. So that's we look forward to briefing the committee over that over the next few months.
Thank you. Well, have you looked at the benefits that we gained during the COVID experience? That it came as a huge shock to everybody, but clear benefits arose from the whole digital transformation and digital engagement that suddenly became possible, particularly for the Parliament that we sit in. Are you covering that issue to see whether we're retaining the best of that, or are we giving that up and going back to the way we were?
In short, yes, we are. And Anthony might want to say a bit more about some of the specifics we're looking at, but I know the committee will have heard many times, for example, about some of the specific approaches that came to life during the course of the pandemic and have stayed with us. So, and back to Mr. Simpson's question, as part of the GP access near me was a very important feature of that. So we're looking at aspects of that service transformation in this report too. So you're right, it's not one or the other, I think is the point of digital access or digital exclusion. It is here to stay. It will continue to transform public services, but public bodies have a duty to make sure that they clearly communicate that and that their transformation is accessible for all people who rely on the service.
I don't really have much to add to that, to be honest, Mr. Coffey. I think Stephen's given you a really good overview of what we're finding in the work.
Okay, and just lastly on that digital issue, the journey that we make towards inclusion isn't totally driven by the digital agenda. There has to be a parallel a participation for people that can't participate for one reason or another in the whole digital side. There has to be, services have to be available to people that aren't in the digital world, don't want to be, can't afford to be, and so on. Have you looked at that to make sure that balance is there?
That's been a really important theme in the work, Mr. Coffey, yeah. So when you get the report, we'll be able to read a bit more about that in due course.
Okay. I'll wait for the report. I wonder, Stephen, if I could ask you a broader question about how the government spends its money. And you yourself, throughout your report and your slide, you talk about reducing inequalities. It transcends almost everything that you've reported on. When you look at inequalities, whether it's poverty or ill health or access to transport and access to the job market, will you be looking at how the government spends money, perhaps even regionally in Scotland, to try to ensure fairness and appropriateness of spend to try and tackle these inequalities throughout Scotland?
Very much so, Mr. Coffey. I think we're looking at, I suppose, the themes that are shaping the decisions that I'm making and the prioritisation that I've made through this work programme. Access to services, improving life chances, tackling inequalities are at the heart of the audit work that I want to take, that it is meaningful and has an impact on what remains very scarce public spending resources. That maybe a couple of examples that maybe will help, again, kind of inform where we go and the committee's interest. I alluded to earlier that we're planning to undertake a performance audit on the Scottish Government's overall arrangements, how it's supporting fiscal sustainability and the progress that it's making on public sector reform, quite broad-ranging. But really that prioritisation that still is to happen, Mr. Coffey, in terms of the pace of public sector reform and how government is performing in that area. There are many aspects that are also relevant to areas of interest. We've talked about Scotland's colleges, for example. And we're also, we've got a specific piece of work that's slightly tangential on the work of the Scottish National Investment Bank, We're thinking where we go after that in terms of the work of enterprise agencies, and then, you know, tracking closely what's happening with the skills agenda in Scotland too. So a pipeline of work, yes, and then more to come thereafter.
OK. Could I also try a question on the local authority funding model that always causes arguments and disputes, and everyone's scared to touch it. But by and large, if you look at an authority that's losing population, they get less money. And if you look at an authority that's getting more population, they get more money. But you could argue that service delivery for an authority that's losing population, they still have to deliver the same level of service, even if they're losing population. Do you look at that? I mean, it's a tricky area to get anywhere close to the local authority funding model. But is it something you've ever had a go at and would be willing to do some work on?
I'll bring Anthony in on this one, Mr. Coffey, because it feels like more like territory for the Accounts Commission than it does for me as the Auditor General, given... you're right, it is and it can be a contentious issue in terms of the local government funding allocation model. What I haven't done as Auditor General is look at how the Scottish Government, this is about prioritisation, effectively choose to allocate funding across different budget heads. I think the report I mentioned of progress on fiscal sustainability and public sector reform will be of interest and potential relevance in this area. But as Auditor General, I haven't and I don't have any direct plans to look at the specifics of local government funding model. I think it probably is more, if there is an audit angle specifically, it's more for the Accounts Commission and maybe for Anthony to say further.
The Auditor General is quite right. This is a matter of great interest to the Accounts Commission in terms of the overall quantum of funding that local authorities receive and how well they use it. There's been a live discussion, I think, and it's still ongoing around the nature of the funding model and whether or not it's sufficiently agile to reflect the changing circumstances of local authorities. And there are differing views about that, Mr. Coffey. Yeah. As you can imagine, in these circumstances, many people have given a lot of thought to the model that we have at the moment. And I'm minded almost to use Churchill's comment around democracy and how the funding model... No one's yet found a better model than the one we have at the moment, even though it has many imperfections and upsides as well as downsides. We're probably more interested at the moment around the progress that's been made around the Verity House Agreement and discussions that are taking place around future models of accountability and funding for local authorities. And when the position gets clearer on the Verity House Agreement, I think the Accounts Commission may want to take a view on that and report on it.
Great, thank you for that. And lastly, from me, just finally on the growth deals. Are you continuing to monitor progress with the spend and the growth deals and possibly also the levelling up funding, which is the replacement European Union funding? Are you getting anywhere close to that to give us some kind of perspective on what's happening?
So on those two parts, take them in reverse. There's been little developments, regrettably, Mr. Coffey, in terms of the progress around growth deals so far. I think you've had correspondence, I'm trying to remember, when, over a year ago, I think now, convener from both myself and the Accounts Commission that restates our interest in this area that we'll be tracking and reporting either through the annual audit or at an appropriate point more generally to satisfy the committee and Parliament's interest in this area. And on growth deals, we've recently reported some outputs on progress in this area. We'll give that further consideration about, and I think particularly looking about what comes next in terms of growth deals, financial investment, capital implications, Mr. Coffey, in a very tight fiscal environment. So very much on our radar, but we haven't yet got a specific to do further yet.
Okay. Thanks very much for that.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. For a final set of questions and observations, I'm going to invite the Deputy Convener, Jamie Green, to put those to you. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. And I've got four quite meaty areas to cover and really not a lot of time to cover them, which is unfortunate. But we'll do our best. The first is on justice, which you mentioned in your opening comments. I appreciate there's some ongoing work around the prisons and prison populations, remand numbers, the sorts of issues that we've delved into a lot. Also looking at court case backlogs and other live issues there, and I get the impression you'll be keeping a watching brief on those, but I'm interested more in what extra or additional audit work you might be doing in the justice sector. There was some mention of community justice and legal aid. What would those look like?
Yes, you've So to be absolutely clear, we're very focused on this area of public service delivery, tracking, of course, you know, the committee's ongoing interest in following the Section 22 report on the prison service, and I'll take a view as appropriate how best to follow up that in terms of public audit reporting. We have live interest following up our community justice briefing paper from 2021, and also, I think, which is referred to in the court's backlog audit, the differing views, I think it's fair to say, about the legal aid services in Scotland. What I've engaged with colleagues very recently on this is thinking, I think, perhaps similar to our work on the NHS, is how we are developing our audit commentary on Scotland's justice system, which I think is laid bare. This is an interconnected system that, you know, that, and single points of failure can impact across the system. So we're just thinking carefully how we best target our audit resource in this area, Deputy Convener. But those two areas are live, and I think waiting to see what happens probably on the back of the committee's own work on Scotland's prison service before we settle definitively on where we go next.
Yep. I mean, you mentioned legal aid. That's clearly an area of dispute between the sector and the government. All the warnings seem to be the sector thinks it's on its knees, that we're facing down the barrel of real big black holes in terms of legal representation, which does actually prove quite a worrying perspective from a democratic point of view, whereas the government think this is a discussion around fees, for example. So are you just looking at the monetary value that government gives to the sector, or are you looking at wider issues such as workforce issues that may come down the line? We hear anecdotally that it's an ageing workforce and fewer entrants and so on. So how much level of detail will you go into when you're looking at legal aid?
Mark can say more, Deputy Convener, but we haven't scoped out the work specifically, but all of those factors are relevant that we will consider before settling on the type of work that we can intend to carry out.
Yeah. And as with anything where we've not decided the scope, anything could be within scope. I will say, though, that I think our discussions with Scottish Government and others in the sector suggest that there has been some progress in relation to some of those areas of dispute, but we await to see the outcome of all of that. More discussions going on, more involvement, I think, of those in the sector. But we're keen to keep a close eye on that to make sure that things do change.
Yeah. I mean, progress is always a subjective analysis of negotiations. On the community justice, what work will you be doing? I appreciate that your predecessor did an initial report into the establishment of Community Justice Scotland off the back of its establishment through the 2016 Act. And obviously the government itself published the National Strategy for Community Justice in 2022. Will you be looking at responding directly to progress made on that strategy?
Again, we haven't settled specifically on it yet. I produced a briefing paper in 21 on the progress on community justice arrangements, and really, as we've kind of touched on, that hadn't progressed as intended against the requirements of the legislation. I think we're carefully, as with all these things, prioritising where we can best have impact on public services, Deputy Convener. So community justice is a very relevant part of the success of the overall community justice system. So we had initially thought about doing a wide-ranging piece of work on community justice arrangements, but I haven't settled quite on that yet, if that's going to be the right contribution to the justice system at the moment. If we do intend to do so, we'll very much look at the progress that's being made. A reason I'm being slightly guarded is that I don't necessarily want to repeat a story that's already known in the system. So just thinking carefully, probably over the next 4 or 5 months about before we settle definitively on what audit work we'll carry out.
Okay, that's helpful. I mean, one of the main issues is following the money. There are so many stakeholders involved in delivery that have both statutory and non-statutory duties in delivering community justice. It's very difficult to find out where that bigger budget goes unless it's directly attributed to a single agency such as Community Justice Scotland. So that's something that our committees have struggled with for many years in terms of outputs. We also, as you're aware, we've done a lot of work on the input or the use of the private sector in justice, and I won't go into that today because I think there'll be other opportunities to look at that and the use of companies like Serco, GAME, etc. But in the interest of time, I'll probably park the justice questions for now. I said they're quite meaty, unfortunately. The next one's the National Care Service, you'll be pleased to know. It's obviously been a point of controversy, both politically and among stakeholders, but moving on from that, I'm quite keen to see what work Audit Scotland will do around its auditing of the preparations and then potential implementation from it, particularly from a financial point of view. And that is particularly relevant because, as we know, the Finance Committee of this Parliament had quite grave reservations about the financial memorandum associated with the legislation. So, and this is on a cross-party basis. So I'm hoping that that will feature.
Yeah, and Anthony can come in a second, Deputy Convener. I think it's very much part of our audit interest. I think I alluded to earlier that we have models of audit response to accompany large-scale developments in responsibilities coming to the Scottish Parliament. Particularly the model that I think is most appropriate here is the devolved benefits arrangements. And that Audit Scotland produced a number of reports as progress was being made in the establishment of Social Security Scotland. And I think that's broadly similar how I would imagine our audit response to the development of the National Care Service in Scotland will go. For a variety of reasons that you allude to, I think we probably thought we would have done more audit work in this area before now. Mm-hmm. And it's applicable to both myself and the Accounts Commission, who currently oversee the work of integrated joint boards. And I think that's where we will go next, together, joint audit on both the developments that have been implemented and then at the right point that they deliver as intended. So I suspect this will be a programme of work that will be continue beyond my term of office as the Auditor General. I think that's reflective of a large-scale programme, significant value of public money. Before passing to Anthony, I'll maybe just say you mentioned the Finance Committee's interest. We also responded to the call for views on the financial memorandum and just, again, the importance of clear numbers supported by information, transparently reported, and that's something that will be captured in our audit work going forward.
Yeah, I mean, just to say we're committed to a three-phase approach. Phase one, as Stephen said, would be the planning risk assessment for implementation of the National Care Service. Phase two would be when it's implemented, was it actually delivered on time to budget? And then phase three would be longer-term outcomes. Has it actually delivered the intended outcomes in terms of improved quality of service outcomes, efficiency prevention, all those kind of things? That's the framing of our plan to work in this area.
I think that there's maybe just a general worry, and that's that when there's organisational change such as this, particularly consolidation, that there are certain things you can afford to wait a couple of years to wait and see if it's bedded in and it's worked. You know, we talked about Police Scotland and centralisation. You may need to wait 5-10 years for that piece of work. But when you're looking at care, it's a very there's more immediacy to it because it's sort of life and death, if you like. So I think there's maybe a public expectation that we can't afford to wait 4 or 5 years for analysis.
If I might quickly say, after this meeting, I'll be going to the Accounts Commission to brief them on the Integration Joint Board 2024 report that we'll be publishing later this year on behalf of the Accounts Commission, which is a summary of the financial health and the performance of the 30 IJBs in Scotland. We're doing that work because we believe that there are some important issues around social care, which Stephen, as Auditor General of the Commission, reported on. We need to focus on improving workforce issues, getting better commissioning, making sure that people are more effectively involved in decisions that affect their lives, and that's the kind of stuff that we'll pick up on the ongoing work alongside planning for the National Care Service.
The only thing I would add, Deputy Convener, is that you're quite right that, and I think in terms of, you know, our previous audit reporting on social care challenges in Scotland reflected that, you know, whilst National Care Service might offer longer-term solutions, there were very real challenges in the sector here and now, including audit recommendations that accompanied that. So it's a multi-track approach from audit in this regard, about, you know, both through the Accounts Commission's work on IJBs and then audit work that we'll jointly undertake on the progress of the National Care Service into the future.
Mm-hmm. I think the volume of casework that MSPs get regarding social care issues is probably symptomatic of those current and ongoing issues. So look forward to that work. I'll maybe save the next issue till the end, because I think the other issue I was going to come on to in my fourth section is social security and tackling poverty. I think it's very linked to social care, so I'll maybe just go straight into that. I was quite struck in your opening comments that you said that in addition to the very large chunk of money that the government has to spend on healthcare, primary healthcare particularly, that devolved social security and benefits are fast creeping up to be the second largest cost to government, given that a number of benefits are now devolved that weren't hitherto. Could you elaborate a little bit more about any thoughts you have, concerns you have, and particularly what work you might do off the back of that?
Yeah, I'm delighted to do so. I think so. It's our intention to look at two aspects of it, really, the building on audit reporting that we've already undertaken and the progress of the establishment of the agency itself, what benefits are now being paid in Scotland, forecast growth in benefits as well, and then what that means for, firstly, the Scottish budget in the round, and we'll reflect that in the report that we'll produce at the end of this year on Scottish budget and sustainability and public sector reform. Mm-hmm. And then a couple of specifics that will follow thereafter on devolved benefits arrangements. Firstly, an intention to do some work on the disability benefits in Scotland about their cost, the number of people who are claiming disability benefits, and then the forecast growth. We haven't quite scoped out that work yet, Deputy Convener, but I am interested in some of the accompanying arrangements for disability benefit arrangements. In terms of employability schemes and skills agenda that sits very closely alongside that. And to follow probably in 2026/2027, revisiting our work on the government's arrangements to tackle its child poverty reduction ambitions and what role the Scottish Child Payment specifically is having in that. So we've not settled on the scoping of these works, but I think we're given the significance following the Scotland Act that devolved benefits are having in the country and their financial implications, we think they merit some close and significant audit mm-hmm. work.
Just on the on child poverty, so is it your opinion that you will do work to assess whether it's the level of money that's paid, whether it's the right type of benefit, if the benefit when paid is then therefore used in a way that does improve outcomes, or it's very difficult to quantify whether you actually get a positive outcome from simply increasing the amount, for example.
You're right, it is complex, and I think we're mindful of the right boundaries here. Ultimately, there are policy decisions in here too about the type of benefit. I think our interest from an audit perspective is what was spent and did it make a difference? Right. Is it quantifiable? So the timing of it is quite important, actually, because the government is doing their own analysis and their own reporting against the various milestones. So we'll think carefully and just engage with government about their own reporting and then when best to have an audit response. So I think what we're signalling here is that this will come towards the end of this pipeline of audit work.
Right. Okay. And will you be doing any comparative analysis between the demographic situation, I guess, in Scotland, i.e. if we're sitting across the four nations of the UK with relatively, for example, low unemployment, that there is a baseline of people who rely on Social Security, and how that compares to other parts of the UK, i.e. is there any disproportionality in terms of how much it costs government to deliver a sort of baseline of Social Security in Scotland?
Yeah, these are relevant factors, and Mark and Anthony can develop as they wish. But often we find that the comparability of data and information can sometimes be a challenge in making direct and informed comparisons. Where we're able to do so, we will. And I think particularly for this type of audit work, that lends itself to that, because these benefits, whether under different names and different conditions, were being paid before they were devolved to Scotland. So looking to take an audit view about both the cost and, as I've mentioned, are they making a difference as intended? So all these are relevant factors.
Okay, that's all very helpful. So I'll park Social Security. I think we could spend all morning talking about that. And you have already mentioned public sector reform as well, which is built into quite a lot of the lines of questioning. But I did want to just maybe pick up then one last point, and that's going back to a piece of work you did on Scotland's workforce, mm-hmm. which I think is very relevant to public sector reform. Obviously, there are a lot of working adults in Scotland who are directly employed in the public sector, both either through devolved and a mixture of devolved and reserved mm-hmm. public sector functions. But it's in the region of around 500,000 plus, and I know that number has been increasing in recent years, and that's quite a substantial chunk of the workforce. which is clearly comes at a cost to public agencies. I was interested to see that around 80% of all public sector workers work in the NHS or local government, and that the rest of public bodies mop up the rest of those jobs. Is that something you see increasing? Does that pose any flags to you for doing some audit work there? And what work will you be doing around public sector workforce reform?
So we will be looking at this, the government's progress to delivering its public sector reform ambitions in this report that we'll produce towards the end of the year. Maybe come back to workforce in a second, but also looking at the other pillars of public sector reform in terms of use of the estates and progress around digitalisation therein. Our briefing paper on Scotland's or the Scottish Government's public sector workforce touched on many of these areas, so we'll be following through on the progress that is being made from that paper. What we will do, just as we finalise the scoping of it, is to think really carefully about the direction of travel, because some bits will be policy-led, Deputy Convener, so the Government's already committed to growing the NHS workforce. So we'll look at parts of that through this report, but probably more likely in, as we follow up on the NHS overview. I am always careful of the boundary about whether as much of this will be policy-led, but what we want to see is, as the Government sets its own ambitions for reform, what does that mean for the workforce? Is the Government able to deliver on its intentions about the affordability of public service delivery in the round? And as you allude to, public sector workers makes up the significant component of public spending in this area.
Yeah, and actually the resource budgets tend to reflect that, because not only have many of these bodies received inflationary pay rises, which has perhaps eaten into some of the resource budget that was unexpectedly so, given events of the last few years. But the issue around other improvements, digitisation, reforming public service and access to public services, I get the impression, reading numerous reports over the years, in my 8 years here, that we seem to be quite slow in uptake of many of these, that largely the reason for that would be given is that usually involves heavily upfronting capital investment. And of course, as we know, that's a bone of contention at the moment. And many of the spend to save projects which may have been mooted in public sector bodies have been put on hold or cancelled altogether. And there are numerous examples of those. Does that then pose a risk down the line that if we're not spending on capital now to make those necessary digital technological improvements to improve access to public services, we're simply carrying on down the road of doing things as they are, and we'll end up in 5 years with very slow, old-fashioned mechanisms and infrastructure?
That's exactly what we want to explore. You know, the extent to which the various levers for reform either are or excuse me, or aren't in place, and some of that will take funding. You know, so whether it's about capital to support infrastructure changes or technological changes, or whether it's finance available to facilitate changes in the workforce, if that's the government's intention or otherwise, we want to explore whether these arrangements in the round are in place. But I think we've been pretty clear in our reporting that in terms of sustainability, that the current setup is challenged in terms of sustainability as it has grown incrementally. And what plans are they clear, are they set out, are they costed, are they affordable to make the kind of public sector reform changes that we think are needed?
Okay. In the interest of time.
Yeah, thank you. We have run way over time, but thank you very much for giving us full answers to the questions that we put and having an interchange with us about some of the ideas and suggestions the committee has got for where we think you should direct some of your resources. We are going to bring the public part of the meeting to a close. But before I do, can I thank Auditor General Yu for leading the evidence this morning? Can I also thank, though, Anthony Clark and Mark McPherson for the insights that you've given us, which has been very useful indeed. And I will now formally draw the public part of the meeting to a close and move the committee into private session.